practice every day and every breath of our life is an experience with Bhagavan. Can't pinpoint anything very specific, but since Swami had come in his physical form and we all had a chance to be born in that age when Avatar took a physical form, we have had some instances where, you know, he had spoken to us in that physical form as Sri Sathya Sai Baba. Otherwise, every day of our lives, whether we know or not, we are guided by Bhagavan. Sometimes we forget it. And for us not to forget it, he has given us, you know, those instances where we can recollect our conversations with Bhagavan. So every time I'm going to speak now, it's only not that, you know, it is my experience with Bhagavan, but it is a reminder to myself, you know, that, you know, thinking of Bhagavan, it charges me up for the next forthcoming days and months, until again somebody asks me about Bhagavan, you know. It is like a battery recharging. It's like we are all like, you know, batteries,
like
rechargeable batteries. So Swami is the current. Every time, you know, we talk about Bhagavan, we are fully charged, and then slowly we drain. Until another moment, you know, somebody comes and asks about Bhagavan. So in that way, I think all of us are very fortunate that the physical form made us blessed to have a few words with him. What would I say, but, you know, all of you will call me Shravanam. Once Swami was interacting with my family in my house, and then after he had inaugurated my studio in Chennai in 2007, Swami asked me, what is your name? I said, Swami, Sai Shravanam. He said, Sai Shravanam? Shravanam. I said, yes, Swami Shravanam. And Swami said, what is the meaning of Shravanam? I said, Swami, to listen, to hear. Swami said, see, your life is full of sound. Your life is full of music. And today you have a studio. So without sound, without hearing, there is no meaning. And that is why I named you Shravanam. So, only in 2007, 3 decades after I was born, did I even come to know of that fact. Because it seems when I was born, my mother was very, very particular that Swami had to name me. And every time she goes to Puttaparthi, she will try for an opportunity for Bhagavan to name me, but it has never happened. So they used to call me Pintu. But they had to put me in LKG. So what to do? So they named me Sai Nath. And I never had an official name until I was almost 5 years old. One day Bhagavan came and saw my grandfather and he said, ah, your grandson, you have not named him as yet. Swami, they are very particular that only Bhagavan must name. Already that boy is 5 years old. Swami said, Shravanam. And so I would say that, you know, today, every time somebody calls me Shravanam, or when I see myself in a driving license or in passport, the biggest miracle to me was when I was born, he had already written the destiny.
Ah, oh, that's something.
We say Navavida Bhakti Shravanam, Kirtanam, Navapada Sevanam, and all these things. But today, literally, my life is Shravanam. If I don't have hearing, and I have nothing, no value for anything, what would I do? You understand? So, how beautiful Swami's thing. And the best part was, I never realized it. Even when I did the studio and when Swami had come to inaugurate it, nothing came in my mind. I mean, Shravanam Sai Shravanam means okay, something. Until Bhagavan called me, insisted me, saying, what is your name? What is the meaning? And now do you realize why I named you Shravanam? Because your life is full of hearing and
ordained.
So I think these are some things, you know, which actually touches our heart. Sometimes with Swami we think experiences and, you know, Swami knows everything. He's so full of love, he's so abundant that there is no difference between Swami and anybody else. He almost becomes them, so he knows everything. So it is, it's the abundant love that Bhagavan said. Such, there are many, many other instances where Bhagavan has blessed my family, mainly because of my mother. I've had the most number of interactions with Swami. My mother had immense love for Bhagavan, and 2007, after Swami had inaugurated the studio, Swami called us all as a family inside a small room, and Swami kept telling my mother, "Ah, your son must get married, get him married." So I told Swami, "Swami, no, I'm just settling, I don't have money. Starting music business, how I can marry now?" "Ah, no. Marriage and music has nothing to do with each other. Get married." And then he saw my mother and said, "Amma, one nice girl will come. She'll take care of you. She'll not only take care of you, but she'll feed you food with her hands." So, get married. And Swami asked me, "Ah, how many girlfriends do you have?" I said, "Swami, no, nothing." And I smiled. And then Swami said, "Okay, get married as soon as possible." And then he told my mother, "Ma, rest well. You have served your family for so long. So now is time you rest and your son will get married. He's just on top of your house. You know, my studio is just on the first floor. So anytime you call him, he's always there for you." So after Swami left, my whole family was so elated. You are wondering how much Swami is blessing us. Swami has given my son job upstairs. Swami is saying, "Oh, let him get married. Girl will come and take care." You know, this feeling of ecstasy after Swami left. Few months later, I got engaged. And soon after engagement, my mother had fallen sick. One day, you know, she started dropping things from her hand and she said she was very weak. And then when we did the scan, they found a huge lesion in the brain for my mother.
It was malignant.
No, they just said it was a lesion.
Alright.
So, my father was not in town. He was doing service all over India, traveling. So one of the Sai devotee doctors, you know, he said, "This is something very serious. So you have to get her admitted. And one of the local doctors had come home to give her an injection to reduce the lesion, because it was pressurizing the skull, because of which there was weakness she developed in the hand and legs. She told the doctor, "Stop, no injection to me. Without Baba guiding me, without the permission of Swami, I will not take a single tablet. I want Swami to tell that, okay, you can take treatment. Without Baba, I don't want anything." But the doctors were thinking, you know, it was a little too much, because she was already very sick. Went to a point where she couldn't speak properly, and all this in less than 24 hours. And by the time we decided, it was actually on New Year Day, just before Christmas, I was playing tabla in Prashanti Mandir. I had casually written a letter to Bhagavan saying, "Swami, it has been a long time since you have given interview for my family. I would like to have an interview of yours with Amma and Appa. I don't remember you are giving interview for everybody. So please give to my family also." Very innocently, I had written a letter. I was playing tabla and the letter was in my pocket. Swami, during the bhajans, kept on seeing the letter. Then halfway through the bhajans, he said, "Give the letter." So I was playing tabla. The person next to me actually, I didn't take my hand off. The person next to me actually took the letter and gave it to Swami. Swami opened it. He saw like this. And then he saw me and did. You know, he said, "Okay."
That is.
So I was very happy. After Aarti was over and Swami was about to leave and get into his car, he told me, "New Year, January 1st, come with the parents, come in your own car, and Swami will talk to them." I was so excited, I didn't wait to go to my room to take my mobile phone. Outside Ganesh Gate, I went to the STD booth and I called my mother and I said, "Amma, New Year Swami has asked us to come." This was December 23rd, 2006. My mother fell sick and she couldn't do anything. It was 30th of December. 31st, she was partially paralyzed very quickly, and she refused treatment in Chennai. And my father said, anyway, when Amma wants to go see Swami, let us go. And I booked an ambulift, took my mother, flew her to Bangalore. I took my car, Swami said, come in the car. Took my car and I rushed to Bangalore. I left early morning, 3 o'clock, to reach Bangalore on time before the flight lands. Picked up my mother, and then when she got down, mother was already very sick. She could not even walk. So we carried her, put her in the back seat, drove straight to Puttaparthi. We reached January 1st afternoon at 2:45. And already Amma was down, very, very bad condition. She was put in a wheelchair and we took her to Darshan. And then it was very unusual. After she came back from Darshan, Shauri aunty said, why, you know, Mrs. Ramani is sleeping like that in the wheelchair. She didn't talk at all. She was very weak. She was basically swooning. Evening, I came to the room. I tried to give letter to Bhagwan, saying that, you know, my mother is not well. But Swami very nicely ignored me. How much ever I went in the front to give the letter, Swami would look up. He would not take. In the evening, one sevadal came to my house and said, Swami is calling Shravan Kumar. So I said, I am not Shravan Kumar. My name is Sai Shravanam. He said, no, from Yajur Mandir they have sent word. Shravan Kumar. I said, okay, let me go. You know, I rushed, and in the gate, one of the boys was taking care of Swami, was outside, and he said, what happened? Swami was very concerned, what happened? I said, look, this is the condition, this is a lesion in the brain. Swami said, admit your mother in the super specialty hospital, and Swami will come and see her. And moments passed by, you know. As halfway I was coming back to my room, again another sevadal came running and said, Swami is calling you. I went and Swami came down. Yajur Mandir, he was in the hall. Swami and said, don't you have common sense? You are driving cars so fast. Swami said, you are coming at 120 kilometers per hour. And you are not seeing in front of the road. The rear view glass is pointing to your mother who is lying down on the back seat. You are not seeing the road, but you are very concerned that, you know, is your mother okay, and you are driving like this and you don't know what's happening in the front. Your mother is sick. What if all of you become sick? Something happens in the road. Very bad. Never drive so fast. So at that time I was like, you know, we try to give letter and tell Swami something.
Everything.
He knew everything. Then he said, ah, they told in Madras, tuberculosis in the brain and all. No, no. No tuberculosis in the brain. I'll come and see him. And then he said, you and your father have not had food since morning. You are also hungry. Appa is also hungry. Swami said, I'll send you food. He made me wait. Whatever food was prepared for Swami in a carrier, you know, they gave. Swami himself gave it in my hand and said, go give it to your father. Let Amma be in Swami's room in the hospital, not in any room. Let her go to my room. No doctors should check her. I will come and see her. So at that moment I was thinking, what faith my mother would have had. She didn't take a single tablet or an injection. Night passed by, morning bhajans I went to the mandir. Swami came for bhajan. Swami asked, ah, veetukku polam, we'll go home. I didn't understand it properly, you know, it was very soft. And I told Swami, Swami, enga madrasa? Swami said, no, namba veetukku. Then I said, namba veetukku, Swami, to W4A11. I said, you know, inside the ashram. Namba veetukku polam. Amma namba veetukku aishinva. I didn't understand that Swami was telling our home means Yajur Mandir, you know. So, namba veedu means our home. I was telling Chennai, I was telling ashram room. I said, no, bring her. I said, Swami, she is just lying down. No. Bring her. I'll see her. And then I rushed to the hospital, took my mother in the back seat, somehow wrapped some silk sari for her. And then in Yajur Mandir, Swami called us, spoke to us, spent a lot of time telling my mother, don't worry, everything will be fine. Just 1 month from that was my marriage.
Mm.
Swami said, marriage will happen very well. I'll come for your marriage, so many things. And then Swami said, go to Whitefield, do a small checkup, and then go to Chennai. We were so happy. I said, Swami, they are saying it's tuberculosis. Swami said, no tuberculosis. I was like, okay, you're all so happy. Swami prepared food. Swami sent his driver along to take care. So we all came, we went to Whitefield Hospital. When we reached Whitefield Hospital, would you believe? Next day operation, for operation, they were given instruction by Bhagwan that my mother should be operated in the brain the next day. I am here standing in 1 foot saying, Swami told me it's a small checkup. Finish and go to Chennai. But here Whitefield Hospital, the doctors and the team said, we have got message that Amma must be operated for a brain tumor. I said, brain tumor? We didn't show the report to Bhagavan, we didn't say anything. Now this is the instruction that has come, so operation is tomorrow. I said, no knife will go on my mother. I will ask Swami. One of the boys who was in Yajur Mandir called me up and said, no. Swami had only sent this message. So don't worry. Swami said operation will happen tomorrow. I didn't want any messenger. I was so, because it's your own mother.
I can understand. Yeah.
I want Swami to tell me. You know that rage. I again drove back all the way. We reached Prashanti Nila. Morning Swami saw in Yajur Mandir. We reached Whitefield by about 12:30, 1 o'clock. By the time we knew that next day was operation, it was 2:30. By the time I reached Puttaparthi, it will be 5:30. I was like, no matter what, I'll go. I drove again to Puttaparthi, all alone. My mother and father was in Whitefield Hospital.
Right.
Swami had already come out for darshan and they closed the gate.
Mm.
Because Swami was coming via inside, so they didn't allow me inside. I am trying to tell the Sevadala, I have to go see Swami. It's very important, so open the gate. They said, no. Swami is coming inside, you know, can't you see? He can't open. Exactly that is when, I forgot his name, some politician was coming in to see Bhagwan. So they opened the door. I walked along with the politician inside. And Swami was already in bhajan hall. I straight walked to Swami. No permission, nobody could stop me. Straight walked to Swami and Swami and said, Anna, why have you come back? I said, Swami, you said small checkup.
They Swami saying, was in Prashanti Mandir or in the portico?
Swami came via Jain side where they didn't. I entered Kulwant hall.
Hmm.
But we could not walk in front of Bhagwan, no, like that, because Swami was coming in a car.
Okay.
Not in wheelchair, in that car.
Mm-hmm.
So it went straight into the portico.
Portico, okay.
And then once Swami got down from the car, I immediately went to the mandir and Swami had entered the bhajan hall and he was sitting.
Mm.
Right royally I walked in front of Bhagwan from the back door. I straight went to him. Swami said, why did you come back? I said, Swami, they are saying operation tomorrow morning. And then see Bhagwan's love, Swami said, actually, bhajans were going on, Ravi sir was singing. Swami asked mics to be off. Swami said, you know, if I tell there is operation for your mother, you will not be in peace, you will not drive very carefully. You have to take your mother safely there. Your whole family will feel so bad. So I told it's a very small checkup. But tomorrow I will do operation for your mother. And then he said, with the right hand I will hold her, with my left hand, I'll remove all the tumor. Okay, he said. I said, okay, Swami. And then very lovingly, Swami was talking other things to me. He said, now drive back very safely, drive very carefully. He said, tomorrow I'll come. I said, okay, Swami. And then I again reached in the night. And next day, Swami had sent Chakravarti sir to be there personally, so when my mother was getting operated. So such was his love. And then after that, she got discharged. Then we came to, they had removed the tumor, and we found out it was fourth grade brain cancer. So
it's
you know,
the last stage.
The last stage. So she didn't have very long time to live. But Swami in that 1 year gave such intimacy to my family, to his physical form, that not one day we have had tears in our eyes. So much love. One of the moments was just few days before my marriage. My mother was, after the brain operation, her complete left side was paralyzed. Only right was working. Suddenly she went into severe seizures and tremors. And it was so horrible that, you know, it was very difficult to see. I have not been used to that. I didn't know what to do, and Swami had specifically told, don't get her admitted in the hospital. Have mother only at home. I was so disturbed. I was trying to call my father continuously. He would not pick up the phone. He had gone to Erode for a youth conference. Nobody else in the house. Called a local doctor. He came and he said, you have to put her in emergency. Severe tremor from because of the brain.
Epilepsy, convulsions.
I said, no, I can't. I can't take the decision myself. Second thing, you know, Swami has told. At least I must tell my father, and I am desperately trying to reach my father. He wouldn't pick up the phone. So I was just next to my mother. Mother got so exhausted. The episode lasted for about 3-4 minutes. By then she was so exhausted that she closed her eyes and she went into deep sleep because all the muscles got so tired. I was very scared to even move 1 minute out of the room. What if again for Amma it comes, she can't even call me. So even to go to the bathroom I was thinking, I can't. So what I did, this is Fowler's cot, the patient's bed, no? Mm. Next to my mother I got onto that. And I put my hands over her, I leg over her. So in case even if I sleep and if she starts jerking again, I'll know. Time went past 10:30, 12:30, 1:32, 33:30. I didn't realize about my food or something until my phone rang. I got a phone call saying, Sai Ram brother, Swami said you have not had food. I'm calling from Yajur Mandir.
Who was that who called you?
One of Swami's students. So they said, you have not had food. Will you please immediately go have food? I said, sir. And he said, have food and call back on this number so that I can tell Swami that you had food. Then he said, I said, I was trying to, you know, quickly jumble up things, you know, and tell my mother was not well, she was having this tremor and other things, blah, 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 blah. He said, okay. Have food and then call back on this number. I rushed. He also said, Swami is sitting right next to your mother near the leg and he'll take care, but go have food. Now Swami has not had food also. Have food. Then I immediately rushed to the kitchen. I took, it was pulao that day. I made pulao and onion raita. So I was having food. By that time, I finished my food and I went to wash my hand, no? I received another phone call saying, now Swami is happy that you have had food. Such was Swami's love, no? So abundant, so, I mean,
it's endless and it's boundless.
Yeah, even it's beyond what a mother can do. There are so many books we read about omnipresence.
And omniscience and all kinds
you
of...
You have, you know, people say Swami's dreams come, Swami spoke. This was the first time I was so taken aback over the fact that, you know, this was like, suppose we feel the omnipresence of Bhagwan, you always go and try to ask Swami, Swami, this happened, and Swami will acknowledge. Here, I didn't even realize Swami's omnipresence. So ignorant, just taking care of my mother. Until Swami lets me know that He is omnipresent. It's not the vice versa, where we've,
it's the other way around.
We experience omnipresence,
yeah.
And we go to Puttaparthi and we get an acknowledgement. Here we don't, I was so ignorant, I didn't know. Until Swami says, and then after I finished my phone, I was washing my hands, my phone rang. So, this whole episode, so why should I call back and say, okay, I've had food, when actually Swami knows that I have not had food. But it didn't strike to humanly satisfy us. And then, when I was washing my hands, when the phone call came back saying, Swami is now happy you have had food. And then I was given instruction by one of the senior devotees who used to be with Bhagwan. He called me back and he said, look, Swami was mentioning about you. You have to take care of Amma. Amma is not keeping well. Only if you eat properly and you sleep properly will you be able to take care of your mother. So don't skip food. Swami was very concerned. You know, those are some moments where, you know, you are just shook for life. And your faith is so deeply buried, you can never look back. You can never look back. So many times. And this seizures and tremor became almost a daily episode for my mother. And it used to be hell of a time dealing with the situation. During the last phase of her life, 2 days, she had 2 days, not 1 hour, 3 minutes. The seizures started in the morning, never stopped until the next day, continuous. We didn't know what to do. Until again Bhagwan's message came. Came in a physical form. We received a phone call saying, all of you leave the room and just be there outside. Swami said it will stop on its own. Just keep praying. Myself, my father, my wife, and my sister. We just came out of the room and kept saying, Sai Ram, Sai Ram, Sai Ram, Sai Ram. And then after some time, when we opened the door and when we looked in, Amma was in deep sleep. So there is no medicine, no doctor.
Nor is there any explanation to this divine Leela of Swami. Yeah.
Of course there is explanation, pure love. Out of the whole episode, it is not about Swami knowing this or whether Swami is curing cancers. It's a very small. Biggest miracle is His love. Our own family members, in a situation like that, when somebody is not well at home, how many come to help? How many have such immense love for us? When Bhagwan shows multi-million times more love to us, it is so immense, brother. I don't know.
And
it,
that also,
it is an experience.
You are in the hospital with your mother. Swami is calling you up and saying that go eat food. How much is scary?
Yeah,
you know,
I was
like
in my house.
You were
not hospital.
Okay.
In the house. Swami sends a message through a phone call saying that Shravanam has not had food. Ask him to have food. No, those are some things that I think for Janmas I cannot.
I'd also request you to share that instance when Swami gave you a call when you were just coming down the, after lighting the.
My mother's.
That proved the omniscience and omnipresence of Swami once again.
There were actually many instances like that.
But this one would really
touch me. Throughout the episode of my mother's ill health, many, many moments of omnipresence, many, many instructions given when we didn't expect. I'll come to that. When before that, I got married on February 8th 2008. My priority was to rush to Puttaparthi after marriage and tell Swami I got married. You know, so much chaos. Mother was operated for brain cancer just weeks before my marriage, so for me everything was Bhagwan. And Swami gave instructions, everything about my marriage, etc., etc. So I told my wife, is it okay after the Muhurtam? We'll rush immediately to put up the... All of my family members didn't like it. They said, no, you know, when such rituals happen, immediately you should not travel. My aunties and uncles, they said, you should wait one day and then go. I was very particular. 10:30 my wedding happened. 2:30 flight, Indigo, to Bangalore. And then drive to Prashanthi Nilayam. So that evening bhajan, I'm there with my newly wed wife. All planned. So they didn't want to send me and my wife all alone, considering my mother was also sick. So my eldest sister and my brother-in-law, they also joined us. Muhurtam was over, we came home, just sentimentally to put a feet inside the house as a couple. Quickly packed, we rushed to the airport. I told my mother, Amma, I'll go. Amma was bedridden then, but she could speak and, you know, smile and do, not much, but a little. So she said, okay, go and come. I said, Amma, I'll take Swami's Ashiradam and come. She said, okay. We were at the airport, we checked in our baggage, full family, and we were just going near security. I get a phone call. Sai Ram, you know, Swami has sent a message saying that you should not travel to Puttaparthi. Swami said, you have already checked in your baggage. Please take everything back and go back. I said, sir, on Swami's blessing. No, Swami said, today is Bahula Panchami. Newlywed couple should not travel. And you are on your way to Puttaparthi. Swami said, please come after 1 week. And Amma, you should be with Amma. And Swami wants you both as a couple to be with Amma, because you are just newly and she will expect you to be there. See, you know, it was so difficult to get the baggage out and all after putting it for almost, for checking it in into the airport, into the aircraft. And then somebody, some airport manager coming by, he recognized me and said, oh, you're the person who did Confluence of Elements album, love the music and other things, blah 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 blah. You know, he started talking to me. I said, sir, you have to help me, how to get my baggage out. I'm supposed to travel, but looks like I should not travel. I've got some message from Puttaparthi, I have to go back home. Even that Swami arranged. Some airport manager, otherwise it would have been so difficult.
He come in various forms to come and, you know,
got it, and we went home, and you know, that was, there are so many instances like this where you would not be aware that Swami is around. You know, how many times Swami tells in the discourses, I mean, you, above you, below you, besides you,
all
in front of
you,
all around you. Brother, I'm telling you, it's not a joke. It is not a gospel in the discourse. It is truth. It is truth. There is no doubt. One another was when my mother had just passed on, and I was at the funeral, and I just finished the last rites on her, and I was just coming down the staircase. My father received a phone call from Puttaparthi saying, ah, Mrs. Ramani has reached me. You know, such was the timing of Bhagwan. And also, tell Shravanam that he is very tired. He has to drink lots of water. He is very tired and he wants to travel to Puttaparthi immediately. Let him not do that. Let him finish 10 days of all the
rituals
and then ask him to come and see me. So, I mean, which mother on earth can take care of a son so much? So much. So 10 days passed by and I rushed to Puttaparthi after 10 days of my mother passing away. I wanted to see Swami. For some reason Swami would, until then Swami was interacting with me so much. After 10 days when I went to Puttaparthi and I sat, Swami would not see me no matter what. He went to my father, he spoke. Swami was exchanging words about my mother with my father. He consoled my father. He He came into the mandir and I was with the bhajan group. So he would not look at me. He would look elsewhere or he would close his eyes. So I thought, okay, we'll wait for next day bhajan. Many days passed by. Many days. Swami would not look at me, will not take a letter. So I started having a self-blame. What did I take? Did I not take care of my mother very well? Did anything happen? Why is Swami not talking to me? So much went inside me. But deep down my conscience, I was so clear that I took immense care of my mother. There was no way that I could have displeased Bhagwan. But why is he not talking to me? When Bhagwan, who was speaking to me so much, would suddenly decide not to talk to me at all. And then my father said, Swami is like that. You know that purpose is over. So Swami has given us so much love. Months passed by. I tried my fullest effort to at least see Swami, because when he has taken care of my mother and me so much, I wanted to just see Swami and tell, you know, Swami, I am fine. You have given us so much love. I have not cried and I am okay. But when months passed by, no, I started getting very agitated. Why Swami will not speak to me? What wrong did I do? It went to a point where I thought I was becoming a nuisance, sitting in the first row trying to give letter, trying to see Swami, when actually I knew Swami was not looking at me and talking to me. Until in Kodaikanal, Swami had come, and I used to actually do the sound system in Kodaikanal. Even there I told some of my bhajan group members that, you know, I will not come and sit in the front or try to give a letter, because every time I go in the front, Swami will not look at me, he'll look upward. So I felt Swami was very uncomfortable in my presence. So that Kodaikanal trip, I didn't go in the front. I thought to myself, I don't know what happened, but Swami is not talking to me. Last day Swami was leaving to Prashanti from Kodai. So there was this small window through which I was looking at Swami and having his darshan. I didn't want to go in front and see me, because I know if I go, he'll look elsewhere and he'll go somewhere else. So I was near the door and I was trying to see Swami. And Swami actually was telling something to the boy who was pushing the wheelchair like this. Swami was showing hand like this. So the other boy in the sound system said, hey, I think Swami is going to come here. I said, Swami won't come here. It's okay. And they all went out to kneel down and have darshan of Bhagwan. And I was in one small room near the mandir, until tatak, door opened, and there was Bhagwan. And it was like a dream for me. And then Swami became very emotional. His eyes were brimful. I immediately rushed to Bhagwan. I held his hands. I said, Swami. Then he said, Amma. Stand there. I held Swami's hand tightly and said, see Swami, I am dhairya marke. Swami, I am fine. Why Swami? He said, no. I didn't look at you and I didn't speak to you and I didn't take the letter because it was so painful for me to see you. I could not see you and talk. And that is why Swami didn't talk to you. I broke down in front of Bhagwan. I just broke down because still could not recognize Bhagwan's love. I just could not recognize Bhagwan's love. You know, sometimes we just take him for granted. I was only actually self-blaming myself. Did I not take care of my mother well? Why is Swami not talking to me? Then my father telling me, that purpose and period is over, karma. Now we should all proceed and serve Bhagwan. So many things. So look at the love and compassion he had. And he had tears when I didn't have. My eyes were dry. And Swami held my hand and he said, Amma is with me. She is very happy. And then Swami said, Nee dhairyama illa. You are not confident inside. No, you are not brave inside. I said, no Swami. Swami said, velila drama. Outside, you are like, I am fine, I am fine. Inside, you are broken down. Swami can see your inside. And then Swami said, that is why I could not see you. And that day was almost my few last interactions with Bhagwan. From those days I decided, you know, how much ever experience Bhagwan gives us, we still lose faith at many instances. We still forget that Bhagwan is around us. He deceives you with so many things outside us. But even now today, when brother told me, come in front of the camera, you must talk about your experiences, it is for posterity. How many ever eras go, how much ever stories we tell, human mind know, we'll get inspired now. Next moment, we have forgotten Bhagwan. You know?
It's so true.
It's like your own father and mother are there with us. Once they pass away, you will remember all being with them.
I do.
But day-to-day affair, it is gone.
Move on with the wind and
yeah.
on.
Acha, Shravan, now so, I want you to tell me that experience of that life of Pi and how it started.
How your journey began from being an IIT and working with Intel to getting the offer of Life of Pi and then moving on to be an Oscar winner for the entire project.
Yeah.
If you could share that experience with us, it would be really great.
I was a postgraduate in computer science, and then I was at the IIT Madras computer science department. And then I was working in Intel speech laboratory until in Kodaikanal, again Divine Mother had given us an interview, and he asked me, he told me, start music business.
Just out of the blue, from nowhere, just?
Yeah.
Okay.
That was when in my career I had settled. I didn't know what to do.
So before that, how inclined were you with music? While you were doing your IIT and...
I was a tabla player. I used to compose music. I used to go play concerts professionally.
Okay.
I used to be active member of Sundaram Bhajan group.
Okay.
Nothing to do technically, nothing to do with sound engineering, nothing to do with studio, absolutely nothing. I was a musician.
It was just a passion that you
music
used to
business
pursue.
Had no relevance to me, absolutely nothing. So in my career, I was just settled with everything.
Mm-hmm.
Nice salary,
mm-hmm.
you know, finished your education. You know, that period of 26, 27 years old when everything in your life will come to, you know, you'll know where you are.
Exactly, right.
That is when I was taken aback when Swami said do this. I came home, spoke to my parents, said okay, probably I can do a studio. Then they were like, okay, we will do. I started doing the studio, and you know, my father helped me build the studio.
Mm-hmm.
2007 Swami had come to Chennai.
Mm.
And then Swami saw me, and Swami asked, what work do you do? I said, Swami, I don't do any work. I was working, but I left the job. I'm starting music business studio. Swami said, how much money do you give to your father?
Mm.
I said, no money, Swami. I don't give any money. Swami said, why? I said, there's no money. Swami said, okay. And Swami just went away. Until that day evening, Swami again called me. Swami said, where is your house? I said, it's in Adyar. Tomorrow morning I'll come.
Wow.
I said, Swami, my studio is not even ready, it's not even complete. Swami said, it is okay, I will come. Next day morning, before Atirudra Mahayagyam, Swami had come home. We had prepared everything in our house for Bhagwan, and studio was not even finished. Just as he was entering, Swami asked me, a studio, where is your studio? I said, Swami, first floor. Swami said, I'll come. He never came into the house. He came straight to the first floor. I had done a ramp. And my idea was to have ramp because musical instruments, it's easy to pull it. And not
lift it all the way. And
lift it. Swami saw me and said, hey, why do you have ramp? I said, Swami, it's easy for musical instruments to come. Swami laughed and Swami said, you know, it's not for your musical instruments. I wanted to come. I can't walk. So the ramp is for me, not for the musical instrument. And that is when I decided it's Bhagavan's will and wish, whatever happens. We may have planned something, but ultimately it's His will. Swami came to the studio. Swami was asking, what is this, what is that? It was not even complete. And Swami said, these speakers are German, so many such things. And then He said, do you fight with your sisters? I said, no, Swami, I do. He said, if you don't fight with your sisters, you will get all these speakers. Because at that time I didn't have money.
Correct.
My sisters only got me all the speakers. Even that Swami knew. And then Swami told me very subtly, music is the only language that can cross any boundary and barrier. He said it's like the bird. A bird can fly over any country and it will look down and see the boundary. For it, everything is common. He said, music is like that. It has no boundary.
So
with music you must go. And then Swami said, your business should be successful. I said, yes, Swami. Swami said, no partnership. I am your only partner. I said, okay, Swami. And then Swami said, you should work hard and earn good name, because your success will reflect upon me. I have come and inaugurated. So be very sincere. I said, okay. And then Swami said, name should go all around the world. I said, okay, Swami. This was 2007.
He had already hinted towards something big coming your
no
way.
No idea, no hint. Swami's every word is truth.
Yes.
No hints. Years passed by. I was acting against the wave in the industry to somehow fit my name. And then I worked hard. My only job was, Swami said, work hard. So I ended up working hard. Until 2012, I was approached by an email saying, we would like to have samples from your studio. There is a work that we want to get it done. So please send sound samples. So I sent a sound sample. And then there was no reply. 2 days went past. Then some lady called me up, Rebecca. And she called me up and she said, we are very happy with the sounds. Will you be able to record music for us? I said, oh, sure. They said, okay, we will exchange emails, and I gave my details. And when finally the email said, rebecca.morilato@fox.com.
Fox.
Like fox.com. Fox is like, you know, the biggest name in the industry. I was so excited. I said, is this real? They said, I wrote to them saying, what am I working for? They said, it's for a big movie. They didn't give me any details. And then they said, can you connect your studio to mine? I said, what do you mean connection?
In what context? Yeah, I mean,
what connection? They said, no. Whatever you record, we should be able to record here. Whatever we play, you must hear there. Remotely connect two studios. I was not even aware of such a technology. I tried to Google, gather some details, and then I knew I could not actually
reach up to that
level, because I didn't have the knowledge nor the resource to equip within the 1 week that they had asked. So I had a very frank email to them saying, I would be very happy to work on this project, but I do not have the resource and I do not have the time. That's okay, I do not have the time. So I am very glad and happy that you approached me. And then they sent an email back saying, we will give you the resource. Will you be able to get ready in 3 days? Because we like your sound quality. I was so taken aback. I immediately Googled and the license is so expensive.
Mm-hmm.
Say like about $10,000,
$12,000. Oh, that's a huge amount. Right?
And they said they'll buy the license and give it to me on lease. And then 4 days, day and night, no sleep. Because Swami said, work hard. No matter what, no sleep. Even now my wife, is, for her it's a nightmare. I used to be in the studio, connect to London, connect to do, they send the license, try to connect my studio. Internet lines in India are so horrible. somehow found a static IP. Long and short of it was, I finally did a very, very successful test session. Until the real day came where we had to record the vocals and rhythm and everything, we had to work in American time. And then finally, when the video opened up, I saw Ang Lee. It was Hans Zimmer's RCP studio. I'm like going crazy. What is this? Man, this is like huge. You know, it's like this. Somebody calls you and says, okay, can you come and play tennis? And you're like, okay. Can you come and play tournament tomorrow? You say, no, I'm not fit. No, somehow get fit. You'll get completely fit. And then you go there and you have to face Roger Federer. That is how it was for me, you know. And then by Swami's grace, the session went off very well. Not one single problem. It was the first time it ever happened in India this way, remote recording, you know, where musicians perform in my studio and it gets recorded in America live, you know.
And the sound quality is the best?
Yes. You press play here, the machine plays there. They stop there, it stops here. I edit here, it edits there. You know, that level of transport control is in sync.
Wow.
I was the first to do it, you know, for a feature. So all that happened, but I didn't know there was such things that went behind it.
Such big names associated.
No, that, you know, I was the first to do it. I didn't even know about it until many months passed by. And one day my sister calls up and says, hey, this Life of Pi, I saw an announcement that it has got nominated for Oscar. I'm like, what? She said, yeah, I just saw the news. And then I got a call from Fox Studio saying, congratulations, the whole soundtrack team has been nominated for the Oscars.
Wow.
For Life of Pi.
That itself is a very big achievement.
And then, you know, and Sai Prakash from the studio was there next to me in the car when this phone call came. I was actually driving down and coming after some meeting. I was actually doing Bhagwan's work. Sai Pancharatna, some meeting was happening and Sai Prakash was there. Phone call came saying, hello, I'm Rebecca from Fox. Congratulations, our team has got nominated for Oscar. Brother, even now it's like a dream for me. Because you didn't have any expectation. I didn't know what it was. I have no idea. And then finally the soundtrack won the Oscar. And the music director was so good-hearted that he mentioned all our names and he said, without these people, this would have not been possible. Whole country sent wishes to me. Every music director had sent wishes to me, including A.R. Rahman, sir, and, you know, all the top league names. So the whole press, media, my photograph, articles, all Times of India, all these things started carrying me in big name, because as a musician, you could reach there. As an actor, you can go there. But as a technician, it's not, you know,
it's not
something which is very usual. So, Times of India carried an article like this. Sai Shravanam brings proud to India. You know? And then from Chennai to Hollywood. You know, news like that. With all my pictures. And my picture with the director, like Ang Lee. I mean, things that you just can't understand or relate to. And if at all you try to understand, you'll know it's only because of Bhagwan.
Let's go back a few minutes before and say, remember that Swami said that you'll have to go around the entire world.
No,
and
Swami said
your work reflects my work. And
yeah,
and when I relate this way, and I'm getting goosebumps.
Yeah. And then, you know, I tell you, you may be able to walk the red carpet and Oscar. How many of us are fortunate to walk along the red carpet Bhagwan walked?
Completely. Yeah.
So to me, every Sai devotee is much more than an Oscar or a Grammy. Because that's the real red carpet. The carpet of Bhagwan is the highest, that is the only destination for us. And then after that, my career took a very, very good race. Swami gave me that boost. And then internationally, my work has been known. So from long and short of it was from somebody who played tabla in Sundaram and then who loved to compose, make music, to family that wanted him to study and to spend time in IIT Madras, wanted to be an aeronautical engineer, And then Swami turns everything, and today I am a sound designer. And by Swami's grace, most of the country know and recognize the work that I do. So with this I know that we are not responsible for anything that we do. All the efforts I have taken has never led me there. But what he wanted me to do, I am just swimming in that drill arm. And the only thing is, I'll continue to do, you know, be in the saga of working hard and hard and hard. Because with Swami, no, I tell you, you can never take him for granted. One moment can be this. I don't know my tomorrow. I can just shake you in faith. And then you'll again come back.
So all that he expects you to do is walk and follow the guidelines that he's laid down for us.
Very clearly he said, you do your duty. When you come to my studio, he told me, I always had this doubt with, you know, when I go to temple, I will say, Sai Ram, Sai Ram, Sai Ram. I cannot see Rama and Krishna and say, okay, Rama, oh Krishna, Hare Krishna doesn't come. Any temple I go, I see the big idol and I'll say, Sai Ram. Homam will happen. I'll be wondering why people spend so much time doing Chandi Homam. And actually for 400 rupees you can take a ticket and go to Puttaparthi. Really see God and come. Why do you have to put fire so high and then invite God? When actually you can go and see Him, no?
Correct.
So when Swami came.
Achha, Shravan, I want to know that experience of yours when Swami asked you to come and stay with Him in this room. Can you just tell something about that?
It was more like this, you know.
And it was in which year?
Swami's visit 2000.
Can you just elaborate?
Swami, there is nothing to elaborate. We were three boys and
Sundaram
Bhajan
Guru. Or Chennai?
Chennai.
Chennai.
Sundaram
okay.
Bhajan Guru.
Okay.
We were given some duty downstairs to, you know, basically wash vessels, go to the dhobi with all the students. People like Sanket who would come along with Bhagwan, you know, take care of them very well. And, you know, get things organized. Until Swami one day asked, where are the mic boys from Kodai? When we were three boys, Swami had said that, you know, we three boys can be there in the residence where Bhagwan stayed. So Sundaram is not very big, it's a very small place. So from morning to night, we were always there with Bhagwan, right in his physical presence, taking tumbler and flask and everything to his room. See, initially I came to know that many people have had this opportunity with Bhagwan at many instances, like you were telling the other day about how you used to go and lift with Bhagwan. Swami used to interact a lot, but towards 2007 and 2008 and 2009, it was not very easy, you know. Swami was already on wheelchair and, you know, his walking was so different, interaction was much lesser.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was very, very different. So we were all very lucky. We used to stay just outside, we used to sleep outside Swami's. So there were three doors. So Swami said the boys can sleep there. So we used to sleep just outside Swami's room. Go inside. When Swami used to go for darshan and other things, you know, get his room ready. That was 11 days.
Wow.
Daily being with Bhagwan, even after Swami eats, you wash his hand and, you know, get his food ready, be with him. If Swami asks something, take the letters and give insight. I'm sure Sankirt has done that for so many months. We have had one taste of it. But I'd very, very truthfully to tell you, that experience with Bhagwan to me was Swami prepared me to face the illness of my mother. It was not any experience that I could tell about Bhagwan or what happened there. In real sense, all the three of us who stayed upstairs to serve Bhagwan, you know, daily activities, sweeping, mopping, and, you know, like what other seva they'll do. We all think we were three very fortunate people who had a chance to, you know, be in close proximity with Bhagwan. All the three boys, we have had enough toll in our life to face such difficult situations. And when those difficult situations came, no, that was when we realized that Swami exposes you to such proximity and keeps you very close, so that when difficult time comes, no, you will remember all those good instructions, in, you know, how you held Swami's hands, how you made him sit, how, you know, he will come up in the lift, how Swami goes for darshan, how he used to keep water for Swami in a flask. You know, such small things are the only things which is like a booster, a real medicine for us to, you know, think instead of thinking of the hardships.
Thank you very much.
No problem. Thank you.